Well, good morning, good morning, good morning. Hi. Come on in. Good morning to everybody that's also watching online. This morning, I'm Bev Owen, and I'm just another member of the church here, and I'll be doing the hosting this morning. So, what do you think? It's a gorgeous day out there. Such a beautiful fall day. I've been noticing all the beautiful fall colors. I didn't think we were going to have any this year, but this past week has just been awesome and glorious out there. So it's just another way that God shows his glory through his creation. I just think it's awesome to see those gorgeous colors and trees out there. So let's see. The first things first, we'll do some business that we want to have some announcements. We have a couple students that we want to congratulate. Brody King. Good morning. Say all-state choir he made it this year, so we can give Brody a congratulations clap. Say well done. Well done. That's awesome. And then Lane Rogers also qualified for state cross country. So well done to Lane as well. So good. We also wanted to bring attention to the clothing drive that we're doing in conjunction with the Lions Club. So if you have any gently used winter clothing to donate, they're looking for all kinds of stuff. Coats and hats and boots and scarves, gloves, warm socks, any of that winter wear would be very welcomed if you could bring your donations here to the church between the 10th to the 25th of November. So please bring in your items to donate for that. We're also continuing the coin drive for the Blitz for the middle school / junior high. 6th through 9th graders are going on a Blitz on the 12th, 13th of November, and we are helping them with the cost. And so if you have any more spare change, please feel free to drop it off in the container there in the back of the information booth. And then there's also going to be the three C's are helping by having a bake sale. So to bring in your baked goods on November the 7th to also raise funds for the kids so they can go on the Blitz. Let's see, what else do we have? Oh, prayer night is tonight. It's always the fourth Sunday evening of every month, and so that's tonight. And so at 7 o'clock, please come and pray for our congregation and for our church. It's an awesome time of just going before the Lord and laying down our needs and our desires and also the needs of our congregation. The elders are also hosting four half-hour question and answer sessions on Wednesdays after the Wednesday meal. So if you have questions, and they're all mostly about the potential changes to the sanctuary, and so if you have questions about that, they are happy to answer your questions for those items. Let's see. Oh, and let's see. Masks, once again. You know, we've had some people in the congregation who have come down with COVID and so forth. So if you don't feel comfortable, you know, wear a mask. They're encouraged, but, you know, they're not required. So it's up to your individual discretion if you would like to or not like to wear a mask or join us online. So we have a lot of people in our congregation right now who are having all kinds of issues and health problems. They're hurting emotionally and physically. And we just need to go before the Lord and just lay these names and people at his feet and just ask for his comfort and strength to him. So would you please bow with me and we'll spend some time in prayer. Lord our God, we thank you that you are here with us in the midst, through the power of your Holy Spirit. We know that you are here, and that we just pray that we would open our hearts, open our minds to you, to your word today, this morning. And Lord, for so many people in here that are hurting. People who have lost loved ones. We think of Jackie Soska and her family, as she's lost, you know, her mother. And Father, we just pray for them that you would give them comfort during this time of mourning their loss. We also think of the family of Lydia Hamm as they mourn her loss as well. And so, Lord, we also think of those that have had just some diagnoses. So I know we know so many are going through treatments and things right now. We think of Gary Downing. We pray for Virgil Eric, Cindy Dorsey, John Sewick, Lord, Brian Walker, Justin Comer, all of these people who have had so many health issues and diagnoses. Lord, we just pray that you would comfort them and just help them to know to lean into you. Father, we thank you that they would know your presence, that they would draw near to you at this time of just real hardship in their lives. But we know that you are working. You are at work through everything that comes into our lives, and that you have purpose, even when we don't see it. And so, Lord, we ask that you would be with them, strengthen them, comfort them through your word and through each other. As we are here, brothers and sisters in Christ, that we would carry each other's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. So we just thank you, we praise you for this morning, and that we can come together and meet here and honor you with our voices, with our prayers, and Lord, with every part of our being. We thank you and praise you. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, it's time for meet and greet, and feel free to stand up and greet each other as we're here this morning. And then if you would either remain standing or sitting, it doesn't matter, after the done with the meet and greet.
Sit there if you want. It's okay.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah, is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory, hallelujah, is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah to our God. Every praise is to our God. worship with one accord.
Again, God, I'm begging, please, again, I need you.
have a seat.
Am I on?
You're on.
All right, I'm on. Can you hear me?
No.
No?
Did you turn yourself on your pad?
I don't know, did I? Yeah, you're on. Am I on, Maria? Hello? Good morning, church. Well, that's kind of weak for me. It's not how I normally do things. So, good morning, children of God. Is that a little better? So, just a little explanation of how this came about. A couple months ago, Eric came to me. There's just some weird times in the church calendar where there's just gaps between some series, and of course, Eric needs a day off once in a while. And he came up with the idea of having a church member give their testimony, tell their story. And of course, when Eric and Wes want to try something new, I'm their guinea pig. And yes, that's a really bad cop joke. So here I am. Eric wanted to do an interview style at first, and I told him, no, that's not how my world works. I don't answer the questions, I ask them. So, we kind of changed it up, and here it is. It's all of you out there and me up here, and trust me, I am nervous. It doesn't seem like it, but I am. So yeah, and the weird thing is it's ironic how God works. You know, we've gone through the book of Jonah. Eric's talked about bitterness, missed opportunities. You know, just that empty faithfulness is what I call it, where you're acting like you're faithful, but you're really not. And that's my story. I have all of that. So just a little history. I grew up in the Methodist Church. When I was younger, there were a few Sundays where the sermon was given to me in the back seat of a station wagon in the parking lot. Not that that happened all the time. And this is a really key part to my story. In elementary school, my sister met this really cute blonde girl at a church softball game. Because back then, church softball was big. The Methodist Church had a team. The Christian Reformed Church had a team. You know, we went to softball every week, and it was great. So my sister brings this blonde girl home, and of course, you know, I see her and I meet her, and of course, it's Chrissy. And you know, we got to be really close friends, and one day I just walked right up to that girl and I said, I'm going to marry you. And you know, we were third, fourth grade, fifth grade. And then all of a sudden things changed. Chrissy moved away. You know, we stayed in touch, and it was all right. You know, and then I moved into junior high and started my confirmation in class, and at this time had a very, very influential pastor in my life by the name of John Poe. And yes, he was direct descendant of Edgar Allan Poe. Don't ask me how that worked, but it was interesting. And you know, Pastor John was a people person, much like Eric is. He excited. Just he made things fun. He brought it down to your level. We had a good time. And you know, getting into my confirmation class, I was excited. I was excited to be with the Lord. And then as the Methodist Church often does, they take the really good pastor and they move him to a struggling church. And that's what happened. One Sunday, John was gone. And they brought in a newer pastor. And this pastor had her own ideas on what needed to be done, and we started confirmation class all over again because she was not happy with what had been taught. It wasn't right. So, you know, okay, well, we started confirmation all over again, and a couple weeks into it, my bitterness started to grow because her idea of learning about God was, we'd read a chapter of the Bible every week, go through a 50 to 100 question quiz, as you would call it. Some of it direct answer, most of it your interpretation. And every week, I was told that I was wrong. The way I read the good word was wrong. So after many, many weeks, I was so bitter that not only did I dislike her, but I hated this book. Absolutely hated it. And that's when I left. My heart left. Now, I continued going to church because I kept my mom off my back, made her happy, but I wasn't going for me. You know, of course, I got confirmed, and with most people, confirmation, it's a big deal. I didn't care. It wasn't for me. I did it for my parents, did it for my family. It had nothing to do with me. And that's when things in my life started to change. I started making some bad decisions. There were some run-ins with the law to where, you know, I can bring you home or you can go to jail. And I told the cop, no, I'd rather go to jail because if I go home, that's not going to be good. And then, you know, high school started, and I was just a bitter person. You know, I found some people to hang out with, you know, that kind of started getting me going the other direction. Things were turning around a little bit. You know, and one of them was a football coach, and he was also my golf coach, by the name of Rick Braby, and he started to turn things around. I started to focus on football, started to focus on my schooling. I was paying a little bit more attention in church when I went. And even though I was so bitter, God still put opportunities in front of me. My senior year of high school, I found out that I was one of the top 800 football players in the nation, according to ESPN. My very first recruitment letter was from Yale. My second was from Harvard. My third was from the University of Iowa. And granted, I was not an exceptional football player. I was decent. But I had no confidence in myself. You know, Yale, yeah, Harvard, I'm not smart enough to go there. You know, I'm not good enough to play football at Iowa. So I ended up going to Buena Vista University. Down in Storm Lake, and, you know, it was close to home. It was fun. And things still weren't good. I stopped going to church again because I was in college. Started doing what college freshmen do. And it was all right for a while. I was good. And then God put a person in my life by the name of Daisy. Daisy was a soccer player. She was a goalie. And we got really close. And Daisy tried with all of her might to get me to go to church. And I refused. I just told her I couldn't do it. And then the next thing I know, Daisy is not in my friendship zone anymore. She's wanted nothing to do with me. It's like, okay. So then God takes another stab at me, and he brings somebody who I was familiar with back into my life. And at a social establishment where young kids go to dance and have fun and do this stuff, I'm sitting at a table with some friends, drinking some beverages, and I look across this empty dance floor, and there stands Chrissy. Hadn't seen her in years, and there she is. And I walked over to the, you know, I stood up, like, man, I got this. I go marching across the dance floor, and I walk right up to her, and I look her in the eyes, and all I said was, hey, I know you. Turned around and walked away. And I can only imagine what the look on her face was. I was friends with some of her friends at the time, and after that night, they had told me how disappointed she was, what she thought of me. And it was just another missed opportunity, because I don't know where I would have been if I would have said more than, hey, I know you. You know, and after that, it just things started to snowball. I started to drink a lot more. Went into spring football my sophomore year. Tore my quadricep to the point where the doctor told me, you have two choices. You can either walk when you're 40, or you can keep playing football. Well, here I am, 42, and I'm still walking. Nothing stainless steel in here. So after that, I went to Iowa Lakes University, or Iowa Lakes Community College, I guess. And there I met a very influential instructor. Started to change my life around again. Started to go back to church. Graduated with a degree, which was awesome. And after graduation, I moved back home with mom and dad. And lo and behold, somebody else moved back home. And we ran into each other, and we started hanging out. And things were moving along. Things were great. Great to the point where, you know, I bucked up, and I popped a question. And of course, she didn't say, hey, I know you, and walk away. She said yes. And life was good. And then things weren't so good. She had a change of heart. Just wasn't the right time. And that really hurt. And I felt that pain that she felt when I just went up to her and said, hey, I know you. I started drinking about $300 to $400 of alcohol a week. I was almost at rock bottom. I started hanging out with the wrong girl, which really just clogged my mind with horrible things. And then in June of 2002, something great happened. I found out that I had a son. Chrissy and I had Jacob. And from that point on, things changed. I started to clean up my act. Chrissy and I got back together. We finally ended up getting married. You know, I got my first job in law enforcement with the Nobles County Sheriff's Office in Minnesota. And it was good, but there was still something missing. Because I wasn't going to church. I wasn't praying. And things were tough. You know, Chrissy and I lost a baby. We lost our home. We both made a lot of bad decisions. And it just got to the point where I wanted to give up. And then we moved to Ocheyedan, and of course, when we moved to Ocheyedan, our house was right across the street from the church. So we started going. Chrissy was going because she was starting her journey. I was going because it made Chrissy happy. And that was my goal. I wanted her to be happy. So we did that for a while. And then in 2015, Chrissy got the great opportunity to move here to Hudson. And at first, I was kind of reluctant. I didn't want to push the apple cart all the way down the hill and disrupt status quo because I liked it back home. But I came with her. And then we got invited to come to this church by George. And we started coming. and things started to change. You know, I was working at the casino. Wasn't being able to be here every Sunday, but when I was here, I felt something. And then one night at work, I got into a foot pursuit with Waterloo PD, chasing some guy out of the casino, and it's like, hey, you know, I went to school to be a cop. Why am I not being a cop? So then I got hired at the Blackhawk County Sheriff's Office, working in the jail. And finally in 2017, well, August is, I was hired here by the Hudson Police Department. And my first couple months here were a struggle. I really questioned myself if I was cut out to be a cop, if I was supposed to be here. And in October of that year, Christy and I went to our very first Matt Maher concert down in Des Moines. And something spoke to me. There were two songs that really stuck out to me that Matt sings. And the first one is, Lord, I Need You. And the second one that really hit home was a song called Your Love Defends Me. And I don't know what it is about that song, but it really, really, really just hit. So we came back here and things were looking up. I was doing well. And this is the part of the story that some of you have heard, most of you don't know. But in January, it was a very, very bitter, cold, rainy, snowy night. And I got called up to Highway 20. And the events that happened there changed my life forever. I'm not talking about a near miss, almost got hit by a car. I'm not, nothing of that sort. But I got called up there for a gentleman who was walking down the shoulder of the road, and a car that was following him. And I get up there and I find this gentleman alongside the road, and of course I see the car had passed him by and they're stopped on the shoulder, and I'm talking to this man, asking him what's going on, and he says, that's my ex-girlfriend. She wanted to go do meth. I'm tired of being a junkie. I don't want to do it anymore. So I got out and I'm walking. And she won't leave me alone. I was like, all right. Do you have anywhere to stay? He goes, no. My family doesn't like me. They disown me because of my habit. I don't want to stay with her because then all I'm going to do is just go back to my old ways. I'm not going to break this chain. I said, all right. So he said, well, I can't leave you out here on the highway. So I loaded him into my car and drove him to the Quick Star there in Cedar Falls on Nordic and brought him inside, got him situated, made sure he had something warm to drink and this and that. And normally in my job, that's where it ends. You know, we get you off the highway, we get you someplace warm, you're on your own. So I went back to my squad car, and I'm sitting there watching this man through the window, and something tells me, and I hear this voice, it says, do more. Just repeated, thunderous, do more. And I was confused at first, and then I heard it again, and it yelled, do more. And out of nowhere, I started calling dispatch and looking up phone numbers for shelters in Waterloo. Because I was going to find this man someplace warm that had a bed, a hot meal for him to stay. And that's what I did. For 20 minutes, I tried to call every shelter I could find in Waterloo. And nobody had room. And as I put my head down to think, what am I going to do now? The voice said, call Chip. I did. I picked up the phone. I called Chip. He was the pastor here at the time. Told Chip what was going on, and Chip says, yes. You know, the Pastoral Association has money for stuff like this. Go to the nearest hotel. Get this man a hotel room. So I did. I brought this guy over to the Super 8 across the street, got him a hotel room. And when I walked him into his room, he was crying tears of joy. And I looked at him and I said, do you believe in the Lord? And he said, no, not really. And I go, do you mind if I pray for you? And that just blew me away. That is something I have never done. I have never prayed for a complete stranger in front of him or her. And I prayed for that man right there. And of course, as I'm leaving the hotel, there's a song that comes on the radio. And it's Lord, I Need You. And it hits, it hits hard. Because I love that song. And I get about a mile away from, or halfway back to Hudson. And Your Love Defends Me comes on the radio. And that's a song that's never on the radio very often. And I lost it. Absolutely lost, because I got it. I figured it out. So I'm going to read some, scripture here quick before I continue. So we're going to go to Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? And then I said, here I am, Lord. Send me. I heard his voice. And I told him to send me. I did things that I've never done for anyone before. Of course, I come home for dinner, and I walk in the door, and I'm in tears. And Chrissy is just like, oh, what is wrong? All I could say is, I get it. And as I'm telling Chrissy the story of what had just happened and how God touched me, I hear a call for a suicidal person. And it's the gentleman that I had just dealt with. And they're looking for this man. And I immediately run out the door. I get on the radio. It's like, I know where he is. And I go back up there and find him walking across the field. And talked to him and got him convinced that he needed to go to the hospital. And that's what he did. And I can tell you now, I check periodically. And since that first encounter, I have not seen that man's name in any of the arrest logs. I haven't heard his name on the radio. And so I don't know, maybe I may have changed his life. I don't know. So that's where my life really changed. That's where I heard God. And I really felt a drive. And I was sitting here and I watched my wife continue on her journey, watched her get baptized. And of course, I just got hired. I've got this big test coming up. I've got to pass. I've got to get into the academy. And March 11th, 2018, I'll never forget, I was sitting in the back row back there where Dutch is at. And Chip is up here talking about baptism. And of course, I've got my head down because I'd worked the night before, and I'm just kind of like, And I sat straight up and I looked at my wife and to me, I thought I just screamed it. Thankfully, I whispered and turned to her and go, I need to get baptized. And she looks at me and I go, I need to get baptized right now. And of course, my wife being my wife, oh, no, we can't interrupt. Just can wait till after the service. So I was like, okay, I go, but you don't get it. I need to be baptized. Something is telling me I need to be baptized. So after the service, I found Chip in his office, and he was with Tom Peterson. And I walked in, and I go, Tom, I hate to interrupt, but I need to talk to Chip. And Tom's like, oh, okay. I look Chip dead square in the eyes, and I go, I want to get baptized, and it needs to happen today. And kind of caught Chip off guard, and Chip was like, okay, well, you know, where are we going to do this? We don't have anything here right now to do it. So Chip goes, yeah. Chip came up with, we will call a hotel that's got a pool. We'll do it there. So the first hotel Chip calls is the Super 8 on Nordic. The same hotel that I had brought that gentleman in January. And that's where I got baptized. And that's where everything kind of came full circle for me. But of course, you know, with my troubled past, my bitterness, God tested my faith. Because the following day when I tested to get into the police academy, I failed. And in Hudson at the time, under the police chief, failure meant you were fired. And instead of turning to my old ways, I turned to God. I prayed. And those prayers were answered because there are some people in this town who have seen my potential. They had seen the good things I had done so far. And they saved my job. Granted, that made the police chief at the time very, very angry because that's not the way he did things. So he forced me to go down to the IELA executive board, which is about like going before the parole committee, or I can't think of any other good thing to compare it to, but it's not fun. It's 12 people that sit there and just stare at you, and I get it. It was his way of, well, they'll tell him, no, I can't keep him, and then I got to fire him, and the city can't do anything about it. And I prayed the whole ride down there, and I prayed hard. And, of course, after the embarrassing conversation, I had to sit there and explain what had happened, and the board asked, why are you here? Because in the state of Iowa, from the date you get hired, you have 1 year to be enrolled into the law enforcement academy. It doesn't say you can only test once and then you can't do it again. You have 1 year. So they asked the police chief, why are you here? He can test again. He's got till the end of August. And that angered him. That made him very, very angry. And I tell you, the next couple months of work with him were not very pleasant. And I worked my butt off. And I tested other places because I didn't know how things were going to go. You know, I tested in Waterloo. I tested in LaPorte. I tested for Blackhawk County. And every time I'd go to take that test, Your Love Defends Me played on the radio. And every time I heard that song, I passed. So I had a backup plan. You know, when August hit, if I didn't make it, I had a backup plan. I'd leave Hudson, I'd go to LaPorte City, I'd go here, I'd go there. I was good. So August comes around, it's time to go take the test. Of course, I'm nervous. Been working hard. I'm driving over to Hawkeye because that's where we were doing it. waiting with anticipation. Okay, is it going to play? Is the Lord going to play that song on the radio? And it was silence. Nothing. Didn't hear your love defends me. I didn't hear, Lord, I need you. Not a thing. So I get there and I get ready to take the test, and I didn't literally fall on my knees, but in my head and my heart, I fell on my knees and I prayed. And I prayed hard. And I took that test. And test I'd failed before by one push-up. I passed. And not only did I pass, I passed with the numbers needed to pass for the age group younger than me. So I was with the young bucks. It's like, hey, yeah, this is awesome. And the minute I got in the truck to come home, it played on the radio. And I cried the entire way here. Tears of joy, tears of excitement. It was great. So, you know, I started the academy in August. Things were going good. And, of course, you know, my wife, she's like, you know, we've got to celebrate this. Matt Maher's going to be in Kansas City. We'll go. So she surprised me with tickets to go see Matt Maher again. Of course, I, you know, being the super fan now, I write Matt a letter. I wrote Matt a letter of how his music had changed my life and it helped me find God. And as we're driving to Kansas City, I'm like, okay, where's this at again? And she's telling me, oh, it's this great, great, huge, big church. And she puts the address in, and I'm not really starting to figure this out until we get into this neighborhood. And it looked all too familiar. And it was just like a deja vu moment, like I have been here before. And the reason is because I had been. Back when I went to school in Iowa Lakes, studying police science, I spent a week in Kansas City, Missouri with the Kansas City Police Department doing an internship. And that church that we went to see Matt Maher in was smack dab in the middle of the neighborhood where I got my first experience in law enforcement. And everything just has been great from then. I've had many situations where just a simple hug and a handshake, and I've helped people. I've had some really, really tough situations. That prayer has gotten me through. Because I know that I need him. And I know that he defends me. So before I close, just a little, this scripture sits with my heart. And it's a scripture that's used a lot with law enforcement. And it's Matthew 5:9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And it's taken me 40, 42, almost 43 years to figure this out. You know, it doesn't matter how bitter we are or what makes us bitter. He comes for you. He never leaves. And it doesn't matter the empty faithfulness. And what I mean by empty faithfulness is you can come to church every Sunday. You can sit here like I did for many years. But if your heart's not full of joy for God, That's an empty faithfulness. You know, I've learned that his unconditional love is the greatest power in the world. And it doesn't matter if you're trying to run, walk, to get away from him, he's not going to let you go. He will make you hear him. So it's your choice to either hear him or ignore him. But he relentlessly pursues us. And I am thankful that I heard that voice. I'm thankful I had that cold night out on Highway 20. And I am thankful that God brought my family to this church. Because I feel that this church is where it all started for me. So the band's back up here. I'm going to pray quick so we can keep things moving along. So I invite you guys to bow your heads with me. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to share my story. I hope it made sense. I hope it helped somebody realize that I hope it helped this congregation see past the flashing lights, the gun, and see what is behind the badge I wear, the heart that's behind that badge. And Lord, I pray that you wrap your arms around those of us that are sick, those of us that are hurting, those of us that need to hear you like I heard you. And Lord, help those that are bitter. Help those with the empty faithfulness like I had. Help people realize that you don't give up. You pursue relentlessly with your love for us. And Lord, I just pray that each and every one of us can hear your voice every day of our life and know that you are here to guide us and love us through every trial, tribulation, and joyful moment that we have. Lord, thank you.
We're going to sing those two songs that Scott mentioned, and then we're going to bring Jeff Slade up.
You're the one that
Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Strength.
Go ahead and have a seat. Jeff is going to come up and finish us out.
Amen, right, everybody? So as I get set up here real quick, let's give one more huge round of applause to Mr. Wiersma. You got a big man with a big heart and a big amount of faith sitting down here right now, guys. I wish you could see his face right now like I can. The Holy Spirit moves, guys. It moves all of us. Will you pray with me for just one moment, please? Lord, I want to thank you for today. I want to thank you for Scott. What a courageous man. It is not easy doing what he does. And sometimes, Lord, it's not easy to listen when you're guiding us and when you're what you're telling us to do, because sometimes it's not exactly the way that we want to go. But Lord, I want to thank you for giving Scott the courage to listen and to follow you. What an amazing position he is in law enforcement, to influence people in a positive way and to show your love and mercy to people. So again, Lord, thank you so much for him today. Amen. All right, so what we're going to do here this morning, I'm going to take about 10 or 12 minutes, and we're just going to kind of go over the proposed sanctuary changes real quick. I'm going to start with a little bit of history, going back about a year or so, bring everybody up to date. We're going to go over those proposed changes again. We'll have the renderings up on the screen, and then we'll go ahead and...